I'd like to welcome our keynote for the second day of the Overcoming Racism Conference, Sam Grant, who is known as a community organizer who embodies deep democracy. Afro-Ghanaian Sam Grant is a lifelong organizer who has constantly worked on the intersections of cultural, economic, and environmental justice. He co-founded many organizations. They're listed in your program on page 15. At the age of 7, Sam had his first experience of extreme racial violence when his family integrated a white neighborhood in Jacksonville, Florida. He spent the next decade of his life having to literally fight for survival and carries the inner scars of a war survivor. He is an organizing and movement building. His organizing and movement building mentor, Jimmy Boggs, connected Sam to Ubuntu psychology. And this finally brought him forward toward his current transformative path of organizing and facilitation that he brings through his Movement Center for Deep Democracy. His source for improvisation and innovation comes from his healing path as a drummer and his years performing with a small jazz ensemble while in college. He continues to drum. Oh, I don't see your drums today, Sam. He continues to heal. He continues to offer space for improvisational social movement forms. Please help me to welcome Sam Grant, our keynote for today.
So I feel a little bad about trying to use a PowerPoint since the spirit has been set. And the spirit might be saying, yeah, don't do it, Sam, don't do it. So maybe I'll skip it and just keep it real. Good morning. Welcome, and thank you for everything you've done at this moment in your life to do your own healing and to be a resource for the healing of all of your relatives. I'm honored to follow Elder Brother White Hat and the singers who are here on the stage sharing culture, sharing stories, sharing their own healing journey with you. We don't take enough time and space to honor that all of it is about healing. Why is racism still running the game in the United States and in the global economy? It's still running the game because we're too meek. We're too afraid to heal. We're too afraid to look at all of our relatives and honor them as exactly that. There isn't any person, there isn't any blade of grass, there isn't any ripple of water that's not part of you. And yet you live your life as though this defines you, everything above the chin. When you live in colonialism, as everybody in this room does, what's above the chin is your trap. And you know, it's a little bit funny to say that because here we are in an academy, right? And the academy is trying to train this thing. Well, we need to heal the academy too. Because unless the academy reaches you in your heart, in your soul, and nourishes your will to stand on the shoulders proudly and with awareness of what all of your ancestors have done before you to generate peace, harmony, health, and justice for all of us, then you're not yet learning anything. So here in this school, there have been professors who have continued to expound on the myth of the black male violence hypothesis. There have been professors who have talked about how colonialism was good for Africa. Right? So, I mean, it happens. And, Dr. Whitehead talked about, you know, some of his own stories of the boarding schools. When I was in fourth grade, when we integrated this neighborhood in Jacksonville, Florida, on the north side, Mr. Griffin, who was my teacher in the fourth grade, the first day of class, I raised my hand to answer all the questions, and he just said, Sammy, don't bother raising your hand, you're black. Even if you know the answer, it doesn't matter because you're not going anywhere. And you know, we can talk about the past, but the reality is when we think about Minnesota, we think about the lynchings that happened here, we think about the 38 people who were hanged. Think about all of the people who have been lynched by systemic oppression in the Twin Cities today, yesterday, last week, in this year. We are nowhere near being an open, fair, honest society. So as we think about cultivating transformation, it's important to ask ourselves, how do we begin that journey? So one of my students used to wear a little necklace when she'd come to class every day, and it said, "Be the change you wish to see in the world," from Gandhi. And I think that one of the things that we have to do is honor that work that Gandhi did when he was in South Africa, and he came up with the construct of blending the words satya and graha to make truth force or soul force. And what he said is that we have to learn how to be scientists of truth in our own lives. And it's a day-to-day process. It's a day-to-day practice. If we don't work on constant inner transformation, we can't be a resource for transformation on the planet. And what happens is that we get caught in a role, we get defined in a particular aspect of ourselves, and then we start becoming that aspect. This is a pattern that exists within the global dynamic of global apartheid. We think that apartheid is something that ended in South Africa in 1994, but it didn't end yet. We're still part of that legacy of global apartheid. When the government of South Africa wanted to learn how to create apartheid, they came to the United States. We taught them how to create their homeland system. We taught them how to treat their people. My brothers who were here on the stage reminded you of our legacy within this country, of that experience. Everything they said, everything they shared was about their own healing journey. When they pray in their ceremonies, they're praying for your healing journey. Are you on your healing journey? Who are you on your healing journey with? As you continue healing, how are you closing all of the divides with the way that you live your life? Too many of us live in too much fear and block the possibilities for ourselves and block the possibilities for all of us on this planet. So as I talk to you about transformation in an improvisational way, which is cool, just let go of that PowerPoint thing. Often my best lectures in the classroom here at Metro State happen when I just get in the class and I ask my students, should I do the PowerPoint or not? They always say, no, no, no. Because if I don't use the electronics, I have to actually interact with you from a deeper place. And when I do that, the hope is, the prayer is, that it actually touches you in a deeper place. And it's from that deeper place that real possibilities emerge. So, point one, we, as I learned from Jimmy Boggs, suffer from three divides. We have a divide from nature, which our indigenous brothers keep teaching us about. We have a divide from nature. Ecocide precedes genocide. We have a divide from our relatives, our two-legged relatives, which facilitates genocide and racism. Racism is impossible if you see every relative as a relative. And we all are. Look around the room. Look around the room. Right now. Look. These are all your relatives. These are all your relatives. These are all your relatives. They require your unconditional love to blossom. They require your unconditional love to blossom. They require your unconditional love to blossom. You require theirs. But do we give that to each other? Taking classes in organizational science, I learned that 95% of American people no longer know how to listen. Uh-oh. I think that's a recipe for disaster. Because you know what? Without listening, there's no healing. Without listening, there's no healing. So we have to take time to listen to each other. We have to take time to listen to ourselves. We have to take time to talk to the plants. And that's not a borderline psychiatric disorder. It's called botany. But beyond botany, which is another colonial science, it's called relationship. That plant gives you life. Plants photosynthesize energy from the sun, and nothing else on the planet would be possible. Even the oxygen we breathe wouldn't be possible except for the practices of plants. So your life depends on them. You should give them love every day, including singing them songs. So divide from nature, divide from each other. The third divide is equally important. We're divided within. We no longer know ourselves when we're trained to play our part of apartheid. Ask yourself, what does my ego compel me to do? What do people look to me to do? Is that your ego, or is that your soul that people look to? What is it? Often you'll notice that it's your ego. You have set yourself up in an apartheid role. So we, through all of our life's experience, have to heal these three divides. Divide from nature, divide from each other, divide within. I did a workshop back in March for 500 corporate executives, and I asked them, how many of you feel like you can be your full self when you go to work in the morning? There's only one. So even the people who are part of the global 1% are feeling the pain of this apartheid. Even they are feeling it. So we have to heal through this sense that there's an us and a them. We have to get over the luxury of othering and get into the practice of relating. As the indigenous people call it, visiting. Spending time with other people, sharing stories, sharing laughter, sharing crying, sharing whatever it is we have to share in that particular moment and bringing our full self to that space. So, having started with that little introduction, I am Samuel Hugh Grant V. Every Sam Grant has been a community organizer. I have daughters, not sons. My daughters are community organizers. But none of them are named Sam. They have their own names. My dream is that this is the generation, this is the moment in history when we shift from this deeper place of relationship and we say, let me take all of this conditioning of apartheid, all of this conditioning of genocide, all of this conditioning of ecocide, all of these are aspects of historical trauma, and let me pull it out of myself in relationship to you. Let me stand with you, sit with you, in circle while you pull it out of yourself, and let us together pull it out of all of our relatives. We have numerous crises that are intersecting right now around how we're relating to the environment. So climate change, climate turbulence, climate chaos, whatever you choose to call it, who is it impacting? If you look at a map of the Holocaust of climate change, Minnesota is one of the safest places to be. But that's a great danger for people who are here in Minnesota, because that will fortify your complacency. You may not think too much about the people on those island nations. I want you to think about the people on those island nations right this second. We live in a very small world in the internet age. We can connect to people anywhere with internet access, and there's still a whole lot of relatives that don't have it. But we can journey to these places that are being most terribly impacted by everything we've created that we're protecting. And I want to say we have an obligation to pay attention at that higher level. Pay attention to the danger, to the risk, to the death that what we have created facilitates. And honor how everybody in this room, regardless of your color, regardless of your culture, because here we are in the imperial global north that benefits more than any other place in the world from neoliberalism. And yet, neoliberalism is killing black boys in Minneapolis. So this is the best place, the safest place, and yet it's not equally safe. Does that make sense? So in my own organizing work, I used to believe that organizing was about fighting. Fighting. I lived my life as a clenched fist. My first wife, who has since decided that I wasn't healthy enough yet to be in a relationship and moved on, one day she woke me up because I was screaming in my sleep and my fist was clenched. I was foaming at the mouth and I was growling. And she gently grabbed my arm first here and then here and just wobbled it and got me to sit up. And she said, I need to know whatever that is so I can decide if I'm sleeping another night in this bed with you. And I was back in the war zone. I was back on my front porch with white boys with loaded guns aiming at me and pulling the triggers. And I was holding a gun and I was shooting back. And she said, you need to heal that. You need to heal that, or we can't be here together. Because that gets in the way of your capacity to love another human being. I'd never thought about it. I grew up in the age of, you know, revolutionary black nationalism and the American Indian movement for my indigenous brothers here. We used to say, today is a good day to die. If I fade away, let me take 10 of them with me. Right? That's what I grew up with, this kind of military construct, and it was, you know, we worshiped it. We romanced it with our egos. And it was in that moment that I realized that I had to change my definition of what it means to be a warrior in order to be a husband, in order to be a father, in order to be a human being. So I started building relationships with white men. Like from a deeper place, no longer from the head, because I used to, you know, the training was, you think about, you know, you have to figure out whether or not they're part of the clan or not before you can take that next step. This was my training. So I just started listening to their stories and saying, let me know you. And as I began to know them, I felt my cells in my body start to shift, that I didn't have to hold this as a way of being anymore. I could hold this. This constant process of relating to you, of letting you relate to me from this deeper place, healing together as a fundamental aspect of the journey of the two-leggeds in the midst of all of our other relatives here on Earth. So I used to define organizing as fighting. Now I define organizing as healing. When we organize, we start by listening to each other. Listening to stories. In that listening to stories, we begin to recognize things about how the world works that we didn't know. We begin to generate an energy together, an energy based on respect, an energy based on awareness, an energy based on possibilities that emerge because I can finally get out of my skin and say what's been blocked. Racism is a form of blocked energy. That's all it is. It's a form of blocked energy that needs some acupuncture. So just as a little funny thought exercise, since, you know, Dr. Whitehead talked about physics earlier, I want you to imagine that one of your fingers is an acupuncture needle. And I want you to ask yourself, where in your body at this particular moment is racism the most alive? Where is it blocking you? Just think about it. You know what? It might seem silly, but these simple exercises actually work. Think about where you feel most blocked. Use your acupuncture needle and touch it. Use your acupuncture needle and touch it. Pull that needle out, and as you pull that needle out, you just notice that energy washing away. We have an obligation to take care of ourselves as we show up each day for this work in the world. Because if you live according to the mindset, the energy of your wound, what you're offering to the world is the gift of your wound, but not the gift of your healing. We need to offer the world the gift of our healing in order for the world to heal with us. Simple things. We make it difficult, but it's actually pretty simple. We just have to have the courage to be mindful of the simple ways we can approach this. So, a couple of stories. I've got some students here in the room who were in my classroom, got some benefits from being in my classroom, but now they're my mentors because they have, thankfully, exceeded my pitiful example. And they're making a bigger difference in the world than I knew how to make. So, Naida. Hosey. Donna. And even though I got my glasses on, I'm kind of blind. I can't see who else is in there. So if you're one of my students, stand up, please. Oh, Anita. I don't teach at the academy, and I've been on faculty here since 1990 because I love the academy. I'm here at the academy because I'm having a love affair with Ella Baker, who founded the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee and was a key genesis and an example of the power of student movements in healing and changing the world. So I'm here because it's a place that I get the luxury, the privilege, the pleasure of engaging students in the real world. That's exciting to me. So one of my students who isn't here this morning, he came yesterday, Jason Soule, you know, went from being a hardcore gangbanger to, you know, becoming a PhD. And now he teaches here in our criminal justice department. This is an amazing story. But while he was a student here, he found himself, because of his own historical trauma, which gets us a little bit twisted in our capacity to think clearly. He made a mistake of letting a good friend of his store some contraband in his garage. And when he came home from work and he noticed that his house was surrounded and was currently being, you know, raided by the cops, he froze and he ran. And they caught him and they threw him under the clock. He got his court date and he asked me to come and say a few words in his behalf. And so when I got to the court, I said, I have worked with thousands of young African-American men who are trying to do the right thing. And if I had to pick one that I would humbly say, throw me under the bus instead of him, this is the one. Put me in prison for life. Let him be free. He's already exceeded my example. Don't evaluate him by this mistaken judgment. Evaluate him by the journey he's on. Let me give you some evidence. The judge, even though looking at the paper, she'd kind of already decided that she was going to throw him under the bus, she said, I'm violating everything that makes sense to me. And I'm just going to put this, you know, young man on paper and watch him, but I'm not going to put him behind bars. And so he stayed free, and he finished his master's degree and finished his PhD. And he is a key national resource for the healing of black men and the engagement of black men and making this world better for all of us. The commander of the downtown district for the St. Paul Police has partnered with Jason to be a resource to go into all of these key places in downtown where people are maybe going to get caught up in a hustle. And Jason and his people will like slow people down, catch them right here at the heart space, and say, brother, what's up? What's up? What's happening? How you doing? How you doing? What are you hoping? What are you dreaming? What do you need? How can I help you? And because it's him asking these questions, there's no drama. People know his story, people know his spirit, and they have a real talk. And these people get on their journey of healing. Another one of my former students who was here yesterday but couldn't come back this morning, Karen, you know, a young Persian organizer and activist, got on her journey of environmental justice, you know, by being here at Metro State, and has exceeded my example given her national level work working with Van Jones and a lot of our key leaders around environmental justice. She could not get her organization to consider her for a promotion. So she invited me to come and do an intervention because I'm on the board of her organization. So, you know, because I'm on the board, they let me come to a staff meeting. Otherwise, they would have said, no, you can't bring friends with you. So I went to the staff meeting with Karen, and we sat in this circle, and she read a letter to them that she had written about the pain of being the only person of color in a white mainstream organization, and how she gave them evidence by which to evaluate her amazing work. Can you see what I've done? Can you see how it's helped? Do you notice it? Please notice it. This hurts to feel invisible when I show up every day and give it all I've got. You think I'm holding back sometimes, but that's only to protect you. There's times when I know I can't speak because if I do, I might slay you. So I sat with her and them, and everybody said, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. We appreciate your vulnerability and your courage to share with us your experience and how you feel. It hurts us to know that we have hurt you. And I said, thank you for your honest feedback to Karen. But just to give her feedback on a one-to-one in this space, but then not to do it every day, unacceptable. I expect every single one of you, not just her supervisor, to show her love every single day. And I'll be checking on her every day. And if I don't hear that she's getting respect, I will be here. And secondly, Karen has told you that when people from our community walk into this organization, they don't feel welcome. Because all of the symbols are about what matters to the white people in the organization, but there's no symbols here of us and how we're included in the mission of this organization. You gotta change that. Starting tomorrow, I'm coming back to check. And finally, she's given you hints about what she needs from you. I want you to take the hint in and amplify it. And I want you to answer. Answer from your deeper place. Give her the respect and the support that she needs. The next morning, she called me and said, they gave me a promotion. And I said, oh, that must have already been in the works, right? Because it just doesn't happen. She says, no, it's because of our intervention. So now some real talk. Minnesota is a great teacher of apartheid. This is the best place to live in the world, and it's the worst place to live in the world. All of my friends who are organizers in the black world, we talk about the Black Misery Index. How are you doing in your engagements and interrogations of white space in Whitesoda? How's it going for you? How's it going for you? Now, I know that might be a little painful to hear, but I mean, I'm being really nice and gentle today. This is the good, nice me, okay? I don't even think I've sworn yet, have I? I normally do a lot of that. I've even thrown chairs across the classroom to help make an important pedagogical point. So we have a lot of healing to do. And I was about to tell a story and I forgot what it was. Black Misery Index among Black organizers. So look at the employment disparities. We have the worst unemployment disparity for Black people here in Minnesota of all major metro areas. Now, the raw unemployment rate is worse in some other cities, but the ratio, I mean, the relative disparity of white unemployment to Black unemployment is worse here than anywhere else. So even though the oppression index is high for all people, it's particularly high and persistent for American Indians and African Americans here in Minnesota. So you look at child out-of-home placement, you look at the criminal justice system, you look at health disparities, you look at employment disparities, housing disparities, particularly ugly and painful on a daily basis for Indigenous people and Black people. I'm not sure about the numbers. We have to do a lot of work on healing our relationship with data and building powerful, compelling, appropriate, accurate data with each other. But I just looked at a study that said that in order to end the employment disparity for African Americans and American Indians by 2020, we have to create 83,000 additional jobs specifically for Blacks and Indians by 2020 in the Twin Cities metro area. 83,000 additional jobs specifically for Blacks and Indians. So think about everybody in the room right now. And let's imagine everybody in the room is on Facebook or LinkedIn or something like that, and you've got 1,000 friends. If you called all 1,000 of your friends and those with the wherewithal to hire, if they all made the decision to hire an African-American or an American Indian, you referred to them today, could we solve that problem today? Could we? You know, I mean, Naeed is right. Maybe we could. Part of why the severe oppression continues is that we lack the awareness, the imagination, and the courage to act from our most powerful self today. So the journey of transformation begins with you being the bigger you. So Marianne Williamson wrote this great poem that people wrongly attributed to Nelson Mandela as his inaugural speech. And I'm gonna paraphrase it because I don't have a good memory. But at the core, she says, the world needs the biggest you to show up in every instant. We can't afford the small you and neither can you. What does it take for you to be the biggest you? Which is the same thing that Gandhi talked about with Satyagraha. Be your highest self and engage me from there. Because when you engage me from there, it inevitably, because of its energy, gets me to show up from a higher place. Don't engage me from your fear, because I'll respond with fear in kind. What does that create? So one point, Satyagraha. Second point, Ubuntu, healing. We are all in relationship with each other. I am only who I am. I have become who I am through relationship with you. Rugged individualism, me, 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 is a disease. Our elder mother, Atum Azahir, you know, was here yesterday. And in her founding of the Cultural Wellness Center, she said that there are three aspects of disease: the loss of culture, the loss of community, and the rise of individualism. Now, what is an individual once culture and community are gone? It's a shadow. No longer full. It's a shadow. So as we think about this healing journey, we have to acknowledge that colonialism, racism, genocide, ecocide is in all of our cells. We hold it. I have the doctor of political psychology right here in the front row. He knows what I'm talking about. He knows it better than I do. All of our work in every second of our lives has to be decolonizing work. Every second of your life, take a second, take a pause, breathe, decolonizing. Decolonize this space, decolonize this space, decolonize. Notice what happens for you when you do that. I just felt happy. I felt fresh air like I was in a forest, just washing over my soul, just with that simple act. There's a tremendous power of bringing awareness and a high level of intent. If you bring that, stuff will shift. So if we say this is a place that won't practice racism, and then we in each of our relationships say, in this relationship, we won't allow the practice of racism. If we create in our organizations, as you know, Dr. Sue worked on when she was the president here at Metro State, let this be an institution that doesn't practice racism. And then we begin to offer a hand to our relatives and say, let's begin to build more people, more relationships, and more institutions, and more systems that do not practice this. The world will begin to shift through that energy. But we show up in the morning at our job, and we immediately are inundated with all of the flooding images, reminders to keep the shackles on. And we give in. I want you to acknowledge it's a choice you're making. When you give in, it's a choice. You don't have to. But part of the reason you're giving in is that you are not doing the radical decolonizing self-care that the world needs you to do. Because if you do that radical decolonizing self-care, you can't give in. Your body won't let you. That's what we need from you. So I want to begin to talk about how do we do that work. Some of the ways that I am trying to facilitate that work in my organizing. North Minneapolis, anybody from North Minneapolis in the house? Okay, a few Northsiders. North Minneapolis, according to colonial science, is a food desert. Also, according to colonial science, North Minneapolis is a food swamp because it has an abundance of fast food restaurants selling crap. It has an abundance of corner stores, but not full-scale, cooperative grocers that are, selling organics. It has a higher rate of heart disease, obesity, diabetes, and certainly has, within the Twin Cities region, the highest index of historical trauma, which you won't find, matched until you go to one of our reservation communities, right? Or to Little Earth. So, colonial science says that a community like this can't be healed from the inside out. And that if you want to change North Minneapolis, you have to gentrify it. You guys are shaking your head, but you know it's true. People are actively today trying to gentrify North Minneapolis. I sat in with one of our former mayors of North Minneapolis over at the Urban League, and he came right out and said it. I think gentrification would be good for North Minneapolis. I won't tell you which fool it was. Because it could have been any of them. I sat in a room with the former police chief of the city of Minneapolis. This is back in 1988. In 1988, the police were learning to use a new technology, the Thunder Flash Stun Grenade. It says right on the box of the Thunder Flash Stun Grenade, do not use without fire department present. It says right on it. They did a training mission with police officers from all over the state of Minnesota. 80 police officers were there. No fire. threw the thunderflash stun grenade into the house. The house burned down. A senior citizen couple could not escape, and they died. We worked to hold the police chief account. We brought him to a community meeting, and we said, "What the F?" His response was simple and blunt, unlike a Minnesotan. He said, "In the war on drugs, there will be casualties." We threw him out of the meeting immediately. And then we talked to each other, and we're like, okay, that was a little awkward and painful. What do we do? Well, it was obvious to us that we had to have a civilian review authority that would hold the Minneapolis police accountable. Obvious. And it was obvious that it had to be controlled by citizens, not controlled by the police. Obvious, right? Obvious. We won the creation of a civilian review authority. But in order to win it, it was controlled by the police. So is that a victory or not? I'd say no, it's not. I'd say no, it's not. It's not a victory if it doesn't work. Part of our conditioning is if we get anything at all, yay! That's called co-optation. That's a form of weakness when we say, if you stretch, and say, what are the demands that make us feel whole? And how do we win that? If you just take the pinky, well, I mean, where's the energy of all of those demands, all of those basic needs in just the pinky? They're not there. We have to do the deeper work. We have to win all of it. Going back to the French Revolution, we used to believe that the revolutionary process was to first take the state and then design the new society, right? First you take power and then you organize a different form of power. Wrong. If you aren't already actively being that new form of power, you can't create it once you have power. All you can create once you have power is the same thing. So healing is fundamental in this work. Healing shapes your sense of what it looks like to create a new society in the skin of the old. In healing, you create interstitial spaces in society where people are practicing this new way of being in relation to each other. So again, going back to North Minneapolis, looking at this toxic industrial food system and its consequences on our bodies, in our lives, in our families, we have imagined that we can create a local food system that by 2020 co-produces community health and community wealth. And I see Paris sitting here in the audience. Paris Dunning is working with me on this campaign in North Minneapolis. Thank you, Paris. Michael Chaney was here last night, you know, speaking, after the movie that people watched here last night. He's working with us on this campaign. So we've got a growing network of people who are taking on this work. We have built the capacity of 10 black farmers in North Minneapolis who are growing food on 25 urban lots. Because of the tornado, there are 1,873 vacant lots in North Minneapolis. Now, we met with the city and asked the city to give us access to as many of these lots as they could. And so the city went through its little discernment process, and what it offered is the lots that it can't build a house on, the lot that it can't define a possible economic value on. So we're like, thankful. Okay, so we can have the right-of-way, the easement land along the highways and along the boulevards. We'll start there. But we in the community have to get to the point of saying, when we grow our own food, like they did in the Victory Gardens of, the World War II era, during World War II, urban gardens grew 42% of the food in America. Urban gardens grew 42% of the food. So we can grow an abundance of food right in the inner city. We have to heal our relationship with land. We have to build up the soil. We have to stop putting pesticides and fertilizers and herbicides on it, which is like toxic and killing of the soil and ecocidal of our natural way. And we have to learn how to do it in an organic and healthy way. Healthy for the soil is healthy for our bodies. When you take good care of the soil and you take good care of the plants, those plants talk back to you every time you poop. Because what stays in your body is the nutrients defined in your relationship with that soil in the first place. If you have not taken good care of that soil, what comes out of you on the back end is a whole lot of stuff that wasn't nutritious in the first place. And your body feels starved because it's still looking for the nutrition. And so you eat more, you eat more, you eat more, you get bigger, you get sicker. Healing our relationship with food is fundamental. So in North Minneapolis, we have a vision that we're going to grow enough food right in North Minneapolis that everybody can have 5 or more servings of fresh fruit and vegetables every day, grown by local farmers that live on their blocks. Those farmers are going to take their produce and sell it at our growing number of farmers markets. In 2010, we had 0. By the end of that year, we had 1. So 2011, we had 1 farmer's market. Now we have 4 farmer's markets in North Minneapolis, and we have a whole lot of street-side farmer stands. We had no food trucks in North Minneapolis. Now we have 1. By next year, hopefully we'll have 50, right? We've got 25 urban farms. Hopefully by next year, we'll have 50. Hopefully by the year after that, we'll have 100. And these are quarter-acre-sized lots. So right now we have 3 acres under production. We're trying to copy the example of the Wedge Co-op that has its own farm. Its farm does 10,000 pounds of produce per acre. We want to get to the point where black farmers in North Minneapolis can grow 10,000 pounds per acre. That's what we're striving for. Grow our own food, process our own food right in North Minneapolis, develop more 5-star restaurants that all of you come to, fuel our local economy, right? And then we begin to create a lot of closed loops, a lot of relationships. And through all of those relationships, it's a whole lot of beautiful singing, healing, sharing of story, and a new community is emerging in the skin of the old that shows an example of the healing of degraded habitat by people who are part of that habitat saying, we are regenerators. So think about that, regenerator. And I just want you to sort of take that word into your heart, regenerator. Regenerators of our relationship with Earth, regenerators of our relationship with each other, regenerators of our relationship with self. Meditating on those 3 things, I want you to just sort of say it out loud. We are regenerators.
We are regenerators.
It's a little Minnesota meek. Say it like you're at a New Year's Eve party. We are regenerators. Okay. Now say it like you have sitting in your kinosphere all of the babies all over Mother Earth that were just born just now. Say it from the heart.
We are regenerators.
All right. The babies can feel that. Everything is energy, and everything feels energy. So my question to you is, how do you bring that energy out in every single thing you do? We need you to be healthy. We need you to be an agent of healing in your relationship with the rest of us. Anything less is committing. It's actually committing colonialism. Make yourself a colonizing free zone. And if you can't, then just hang out at the dance while the rest of us do it and wait till one of us draws you in, because we're so beautiful, you have to come to the dance. But at least stay back at the wall until you're ready to dance according to decolonizing, because we cannot afford any more colonial energy on Mother Earth. It's formally outlawed right now by decree of the people. It's outlawed. So I'll tell you another story. I had a young student from Ethiopia come into my classroom and say, "I have this dream." I said, "Well, tell me what it is." And so she told me her dream of, you know, healing the habitat in her own country in Ethiopia. And she had a particular way of doing it. I said, "Well, that's exciting. Let's make it a class project." So we made it a class project. My students that semester didn't really get it. So I said, okay, that was probably my fault. I failed as a facilitator. Let me try it again. So the next semester, I made it an invitation for all of my students to partner with her. And we did a summit here at Metro State University on healing this particular pattern in Ethiopia, that in order to eat, people are cutting down all of the trees. And now we're in a situation where people are living in arid environments because the trees are gone. The trees are gone, there's less water. So people are living without access to water, without electricity, so they can't talk to us by internet. Oh, great sin, because we all have to talk to each other, right? So their lives are blocked in many ways, even in the most basic way, because now with the trees gone, their soil is getting worse and worse. So she brought in images of the country, and one of the images was of a woman bending over the hearth to cook food for her family. You imagine what it would be like in your life if you had to bend over like this every day to cook 3 or 4 or 5 meals a day, and in between meals you had to go gather the water and gather the wood. So our first impulse was to focus on a solar cook stove strategy. But after more conversation about it, one of the women in the room from Ethiopia said, "People are dying. We've got babies dying because they're drinking water that's not healthy. So we have to heal our relationship with water first." So water is life, is one of the things you learn from our indigenous relatives, and they're organizing all over the planet. Water is life. So we said, how could we design a strategy that would heal the water, rebuild the forest, and give people an alternative economy in the skin of the old, because the mainstream economy doesn't work for them? So we created a model of integrated watershed management and reforestation that starts with a simple technology of an aerobic digester that a colleague of mine in Ghana created, that we can get access to the first 100 households. So by March of this year, our fantasy, and it's a fantasy because we don't have the money to do this yet, that's where you guys come in. We have a fantasy that by March of this year, we're gonna get these aerobic digesters into the homes of the first 100 families. And because these families are poor, we're not gonna say they have to pay for the aerobic digester. They have to rebuild the forest. So we're giving them credit for reforestation in exchange for cash to rebuild the forest and teach other villagers how to begin to heal their habitat, create a watershed governance model, right? So we think about Vandana Shiva and her talks about earth democracy, as opposed to the kind of democracy we have, a representative democracy where you get to vote for people every few years who will represent part of you, right? So our model of democracy is an apartheid model of democracy. It's not a genuine democracy worthy of the name. Any politicians in the house, I love you. And I look forward to you being a partner in generating the healthy, participatory, direct democracy in the skin of the old that's worthy of the name, because this one is not. This democracy allows the continuation of ecocide, genocide, and colonialism, so that's unacceptable. We have to have a democracy that reaches us in a deeper place, not just where we're at, but in a deeper place that helps us become our greater self. and moves us all from there. Does that make sense? Okay. So this is exciting, just to think about how students, while they're students, are changing the world now. We're not saying, finish our classrooms, get a job, work for 7 years, and then maybe you will emerge as a leader. You already are. So as the song from Sweet Honey in the Rock says, you know, we are the leaders we've been looking for already, right here, right now. Don't look anywhere else for the power to change the world. Look within and look in relationship and look to the plants in your yard. We have to be healing in every second, in every interaction. Otherwise, we're getting in the way of the possibilities that the universe is asking of us. Is this making sense? Okay. It's kind of wild when I go improv. But I think I'm kind of covering the waterfront of what I wanted to share with you. So here's the most simple points. Number one, you need to make the commitment that you're not going to be a resource for racism. You need to make the commitment that you're going to be decolonized, anti-racist in the way that you live every second of your life. Since you are a relative and you can't do that by yourself, you have to organize your life in circles that hold you there. And it has to be true for your circle for it to be true for you. Once you have a circle, then you have to recognize that your circles can very easily get trapped to be a part of apartheid. You have to help your circles connect to all of the other circles. So everybody's struggle is your struggle. In the 1980s, I went up to Canada to a Fourth World Congress of Indigenous people from all over the world gathering and talking about their work to heal their habitat, reclaim their culture, and then be a resource for the healing of all of us. And one of the elders who had called that circle and was one of the organizers of the conference said, very simply, the hurt of one is the hurt of all. Are you aware enough to recognize that anyone's hurt is yours? Are you aware enough? If you're not, you're practicing apartheid. It's that simple. So that doesn't mean I'm sitting in judgment of you. It means that we're on a journey, and take the message of increasing, expanding, connecting more deeply your awareness, and get more connected. Get more connected. As you get more connected, you're gonna run into patterns, because we've all been trained. So the very first time I went up to the Leech Lake Reservation in the 1980s, they were organizing a constitutional convention because they felt like their own tribal government, which had been colonized, wasn't respecting and engaging the people on terms that work for the people. So Irma Visner, and you know, who's now the chairwoman of the White Earth Nation, was one of the people who was agitating and organizing with Ojibwe People for Justice at this time. And I went up there to bring food from all of our local co-ops in my cool little truck. It said official Indian truck on the back, because I got it from a friend of mine on the reservation for $500. And so I went to drop off the produce, and I felt like the energy there was so rich, I had to sit in that circle. And as I began to walk to the circle, somebody ran over and put his hand on my chest and stopped me and said, "We don't want your kind here. This is an Indian brother." And I said, "What's up? Why not?" And he said, "You people," and you know, he might have seen my spirit, right? Because I acknowledge that I grew up revolutionary black nationalist. So if you saw that spirit of revolutionary black nationalist in my walk, then you have a reason to be concerned, because RBN is like, you know, it's a little bit like a Black Panther kind of thing, part of the Black Panther kind of thing, which was willing to stand out on the street corner in the beautiful, beautiful black, you know, attire, holding a gun and a constitution, right? So he saw that, and he assumed that's the energy I was bringing. He says, "We don't want that gun militant energy here. We're trying to heal here." And I said, "I hear that. I respect that. I was invited by, you know, my friend over here. So why don't you guys talk to each other? And if you guys agree that I should go, I'll go. But talk to each other." So my friend said, no, he needs to be in the circle for his own healing, and his healing is part of our healing. We need him here. So my friend who had put his hand on my chest, notice, my friend, right? He is my friend. He is my relative. He's not my adversary. He's not my enemy. He gave me his truth. I greeted him in his truth with my truth as an opening, not as a construct of against. Neither one of us were practicing apartheid. We were practicing truth. And we had the awareness to move there, and so we moved past it. I sat in that circle. I began to get some insight listening to the elders sit around that circle and talk about the dreams for this generation. And I recognized other ways I could help. So I called a friend of mine over on the White Earth Reservation and said, here we are in this tribal encampment, and we don't have a toilet. Do you guys have any old porta-potties you're not using up there? And my friend said, yeah, you can come get one. So I drove up there in my pickup truck, and I picked one up, put it in the back of my truck, and I sped down this dirt road between White Earth and Leech Lake at 100 miles an hour. It felt so good. That porta-potty flew up in the air and out of my truck onto the road, but it was really well built. It didn't break. Got a few dents. So I got it back in the truck and took it over to the encampment. And people are laughing as they see me come up with this dented thing. And saying, Sammy, what happened, man? What is that thing? So I told them the story. And one of the old Indian women there just started laughing, and she gave me my Indian name. Sam goes too fast. And that's really stayed with me. Because the greatest blessing in my life is the blessing of being a father. And my daughter is my greatest healer. Because with her, I bring my greatest self out constantly without fail. With everybody else, it's open to question. But with her, it's automatic and on lock perfectly. So I know perfect love. I know perfect love, and I'm thankful for that. So she, as my teacher, is helping me on my healing journey. And now that I know what it's like to be in that space with her, I have something to offer as I come out to the world and greet with all of you, all of my relatives. So I want you to think about that place in your life, you know, that abundant love that just pours out of you. And let that sit within you every second of your life as you're doing your day-to-day work. Because that's not colonizable. That's not colonizable. Love is the greatest force of transformation. So be love. Be love in every interaction. Every time you're sitting in a circle, every time you're in your classroom, every time you're at the dinner table, every time you're in a meeting that you don't want to be at, be love and transform that space. And ask everybody else to be it with you. So one of the mistakes we make is that we, again, in the individualism, we get caught up in, we have to do it. But we don't. We all have to do it. So as the bigger me emerges, the bigger me necessarily invites the bigger you, the bigger us necessarily invites a healthier discourse in the world, and that shapes a new future. So before I wrap up and close, I want to come back to some more indigenous knowledge. In 1994, during Chiapas, the Zapatista movement, which is still an unfolding dynamic, they talked about this practice of interculturalism. Interculturalism, one world in which many worlds fit. One world in which many worlds fit. How does that relate to our understanding of assimilation and in integration? It's a fundamentally different ethos, a fundamentally different paradigm. Interculturalism, one world where many worlds fit, says, let's sit in a circle with each other and share our stories. But I'm not trying to be like you, right? So FREC, that R-E in FREC is racial equity. I talked to an indigenous brother about structural racism, and he said, I'm a little hesitant with that language, Sam, because for me, it's more important to talk about genocide. Because racial equity is what we fight for after you've taken my land and killed my culture, and you're asking me to fight for equity for jobs, for access to healthcare, for so-and-so, all in a colonial construct. I don't want any of that. I want my land back, brother. I want my songs back. I want my language back. I want my grandma's back. I want to heal. Can you help me with that? You can't help me with that if you're a colonizer. As the Aboriginal woman said, I don't remember her name right now, but she said, if you've come here to help me, leave. But if you've come here because your well-being and your liberation is inextricably caught up with mine, stay. Let's work together. Let's heal together. Let's change the world together. Each one of you has to sort of notice all the ways you're holding colonialism, all of the ways you're holding racism, all of the comforts that you refuse to interrogate. Every time you turn on your water faucet, who in the world doesn't have water? Every time you turn on your light switch, who in the world doesn't have electricity? The president, the United States, China just had this so-called historic gathering where they agreed to do all of this great stuff by 2030. So again, addressing climate change by 2030 is unacceptable. We need to address it right now. We have to heal the fossil fuel addiction right now. We can't wait. But, oh, wait a minute, I got so many benefits from everything that is, maybe tomorrow, maybe next week. It's got to be right now. It's got to be right now. So in my own life, I'm an example of this extreme pitifulness. So I have empathy for you. We're in the same boat. So it's not white versus indigenous versus black versus mestizo versus Asian. It's all of us. All of us as human beings are participating in something that's hurting the earth, hurting each other, and hurting ourselves. We're in different vantage points of the pattern, but all of us are holding the pattern. So my prayer, my wish, my hope, my dream, my day-to-day practice is to remind you, encourage you, partner with you in being transformation, actively being transformation. This is the work that we have to do. So I want to ask you again, because, you know, in my community, we do a whole lot of call and response. I'll say, will you be transformation? And you say, I'll be transformation. Will you be transformation?
I will be transformation.
I say, will you bring everyone with you? And you say, everybody's coming. Will you?
That's my fault. Really poor setup. I'm really good at bad setups, but you know, you get the point. You get the point.
We, look around the room at your relatives here. We are on a journey together. And this journey requires a self, an us, a way of being together that we have participated in blocking. Let go of your blocking posture. Take the stance of vulnerability and be liberation. There's a dialogue we need to have each other about what freedom looks like for us in the 21st century. Can we create a world in which everybody can have what Americans have? What the middle class, supposed middle class Americans have? I mean, what is that? It's another, you know, mythical construct. As we see more and more of our relatives living in their parents' basements or parents living in their kids' basements, right? Which is actually a good thing when, you know, the circle comes back together again. But not because the economy is making it together. Let us come back together because we love each other and we enjoy each other's company. Let that be the reason we come back together. How am I doing for time? Good? Okay. Awesome. All right. So this is part of the dynamic of apartheid, excuse me, of improv. Isn't that funny? A Samian slip? Yeah. Yeah. Questions and answers? Sure. Is it time for that? All right. So Q&A, what you got to say? One more comment I'll make is just, again, to honor, say, well, one, thank you for being here. Thank you to the organizers for starting it off with the indigenous space and bringing us all into it. In 1983, my brother, who is now the president of White Earth Tribal College, who's from the Pine Ridge Reservation, talk about juxtapositions and, you know, just how wild the world is, started to get on his healing journey to go to sweat lodges. And he asked me to come with him because he was a little nervous about it and he hadn't been, and I'm his brother. So of course I'm gonna say yes. So I go to the sweat lodge with my brother and I meet this elder who was running the sweat lodge, Amos Owen. And that was one of those moments that changed my life. Because at the end of, you know, the sweat, you know, Amos says, I really like the way you pray and you bring the whole world in. It's beautiful for me to listen to it. But I notice a profound discord in you. I can feel how divided you feel. And I want you to acknowledge that you have a choice to make about whether you lean into truly being healthy or whether you want to let your anger control you. So being at that sweat and making a commitment to being on that healing journey, I changed my relationship with anger. And I have to acknowledge it's been a slow process to change the relationship with anger enough that I don't seethe at the mouth as much. I'm not done on that healing journey. There's still triggers that catch me, right? So let's be patient with ourselves. Shut up, Sam.
It seems to me that one of the fundamental impulses of colonization is acquisition. And are you speaking of that within all of us we need to tame that impulse?
Indeed, I am saying that. So the indigenous people of Ecuador, in their practice of interculturalism, have come up with this construct of buen vivir. In their own language, which I can't speak, but on paper it looks like samak kase, but I don't know how to say it right, but that's what it looks like, right? So it's about living well, as opposed to being acquisitive. Because instead of have more, want mores, have enough, will shares. So we need to create a world of have enough, will shares, and heal through that pattern of have a lot and still want a lot more. Because as long as it's about getting more, we're gonna keep burning all of the oil. We're gonna keep getting all of the coal. We're going to keep facilitating ecocide and genocide until there are no relatives left. So yes, this basic pattern that we carry, all of this technology of wanting to control, part of what we have to let go of is the need for control and focus on relationship as opposed to control. Thank you for asking.
I do have a question, but I'm actually kind of concerned that we have two white men asking the only question. So I just want to make sure that there isn't anyone else that has a question. Okay.
Thank you so much. I was just cringing at that, so I appreciate that. Hey, Sam, I love you.
How you doing, sweetie?
My name is Jana. If there are any Arabs here, I'd love to connect with you. It's a pretty Arab-free zone besides me so far that I've noticed. My question for you is, I really appreciate your the interconnected loops of healing and community and being activists and change makers. Can you point us towards a system? I work for the government, you know that, so it's all about tangible. So what are some specific healing practices? You talked about singing and dancing and acupuncture, but what are some other healing practices that you can point us towards? Thanks.
the most important healing practice is tapping into your own body wisdom. So if you ask your trap, how do I heal? You won't get a useful answer, because it'll probably say Excedrin, something like that, you know? But if you come down here to your solar plexus and you ask yourself, where do I need healing and how do I begin to heal? And you just do this back and forth, you let your body tell you what medicine you need right now, and your own body will tell you. We don't talk to our own bodies. You don't need a doctor out there. The doctor is in the house.
I am really geeked that you talked about like our separation from nature. I'm a geography student at the University of Minnesota, and I study how migration culture fit into our outdoor spaces and like parks as a form of colonization. And I'm interested in why and what you think is like the largest constraint for communities of color to be engaged with nature and to be engaged with our environment.
That's a really important question. I think most of us no longer living in the natural way have, you know, what this great scholar, activist, you know, called the natural deficit disorder. So it's like it's a common human ailment that we, you know, live in heat islands, we live in concrete jungles, we've removed ourselves. Even if we live in rural America, we're part of the industrial food system, and we're living our lives in a way that don't allow us to have a deep inherent relationship with all of our relatives. So I think it's important that people heal at the cosmological level. So as indigenous people who are involved in the Great Lakes Commons, so Google that, Great Lakes Commons, in organizing the commons, which is saying, you know, this indigenous sister from the Muckleshoot Nation said, we live under the laws, the land, the air, the water, the sea. That's law. That's the basis of life. So if we begin to live by the basis of life, how do we juxtapose neoliberal world capitalist system within that? Where's the relationship? There's a lot of interesting scholars who are saying that we can have both. We can have our cake and eat it too. We can have capitalism and we can also have healthy nature. So all of the work on natural capitalism is trying to, you know, look at how do we do that. I want to say, well, imagine maybe not. Open your imagination, you know, maybe to an aspect that will work, but we need to open our radical imagination and we need to think about how do we come back to nature. I refuse to wear something close to my neck because of the historical trauma of lynching, so I can't wear a tie, except when my mother tells me I have to. It's the only time I do it, but otherwise I can't wear a tie. I can't have anything tight on my neck. When I used to talk to black boys and girls, and indigenous boys and girls about coming back out to nature, the black boys and girls said, no, man, the Klan is out there. I can't be around trees. The kids today aren't saying that. Kids today are hungry to connect to nature, and it's the adults that are blocking them. So what we have to do is help the adults heal so that all of us are re-engaging ourselves in nature. So it's exciting right now to get kids back involved and have the kids be agents of the rest of us getting involved in our healing journey. So just start to do the math in your own life. How much time are you spending outside? How much time are you spending talking to plants? How much time are you spending looking at the earthworms and the stuff you can't see, the invisible realm in your soil? How much time are you taking care of water and thinking about how every aspect of your life is ecological and it must become ecologically wise? Shut up, Sam. Is that it? Okay.
I think our time is up. Thank you so much, Sam.
Thank you.